Do you remember getting the call from California about a link between the Lisa Project and those Allenstown murders?
I certainly remember that time frame where this was all coming down.
This is Denise Bowden. She went missing in the fall of 1981 from Manchester, New Hampshire. At the time she went missing, she had a six-month-old daughter. When Denise and Lisa went missing in 1981, they were with this man. Denise was never seen or heard from again. However, we know that Evans kept that little girl with him for several years. And around the time she was 5 or 6, he gave her away to some people in California.
He was wanted for 12 years for deserting that girl, but he eventually was convicted of murdering someone in California and died in prison. Using DNA, authorities learned the abandoned girl, adopted and now grown, was not Evans' daughter.
They essentially had an adult Jane Doe who didn't know what her true identity was, and they were working with her via genetic genealogy to try to locate relatives and locate who her true family members were.
That was the initiation of the so-called Lisa Project. I'm Deputy Headley, work for San Bernardino County Sheriff's Department. With Lisa, I'd actually taken a look at ancestry and the past, and the databases were still pretty small back then. And then in discussing it with her, she brought it up herself, and I got some distant cousin matches, and I thought, wow, this might just work. Usually with an adoptee, you have some geographic information, and we had nothing. We had no idea where he took her from. Working with genetic genealogy, you have to build a tree up from your matches to your subject. And then once you get an ancestor in common for several generations back or more, then you have to build that tree back down, and your subject is going to be in that family tree. The family trees get huge. Eventually, they're all going to cross at an ancestor in common. And then you have to follow those trees back down. Then once you start getting further down in the trees to the living folk, that's when I would call them up, contact them, and just tell them what's going on and say, you're related to our victim. We don't know how close or how distant. Will you test? Ended up getting a match of a first cousin of Denise Bowden. Call it a hunch, but how many missing people do you have out of one family? When they suddenly moved away, sometime between Thanksgiving and Christmas of 1981, the family believed that they were just on the run from bad debts, so they never made a missing person report. And I know people have been throwing out criticism, why didn't they report him missing, but you got to remember the time. There were no cell phones, there was no social media, and if someone moved away, the only contact was by a letter or a phone call, a landline. That was it.
So do you have any evidence of whatever happened to her, Denise?
Based on his history, I'm sure he killed her. As far as when and where, we don't know. Obviously, sometime between when they left New Hampshire, the end of 1981, and when he showed up in California in 1984. NECMEC contacted me and said, hey, there's a case down the road, the Allenstown murders, and you need to talk to New Hampshire State Police. That's when I got in touch with Mike Kokoski, and I just sent him a copy of my whole case file. And we started comparing and connecting dots between Rasmussen, AKA Bob Evans, and the Allenstown case.
We would have many, many long phone calls, of course, coast to coast, discussing these events and details as they unfolded, and sharing our thoughts on where we thought this was heading. California was looking at this case, trying to identify their adult, who had been a child back at the time of all these events, and essentially telling the Manchester Police Department, it looks like there's a missing woman here who disappeared in 1981 from the city. And our connection was that, given that the Allenstown case was so close in proximity and time to those events, we now had somebody who was at least a person of interest in terms of possibly being connected to these murders that were so close. I think our initial impression wasn't necessarily, aha, this is the guy. It was more, boy, this is interesting. And this is the kind of guy who this case might come back to. Somebody who was transient, somebody who had clearly had a checkered past, somebody who was potentially involved in another disappearance. The time frame made sense.
At that point, I wrote a report up on it and contacted Manchester Police Department and had them contact Lisa's grandfather and ask for DNA from him. When they showed a picture of Rasmussen to Lisa's grandfather, he identified him as Bob Evans.
And that further
locked it up that yes, this is who Lisa is, Dawn Bowden. So he let Lisa know who she is.
Bowden's daughter, known as Lisa, lives in California with her husband and children. In a statement, she says that she's thankful to be reunited with her relatives and hopes that other families of the victims can find closure as this investigation continues.
Family recognized the convicted killer as Evans and provided a crucial link. Authorities then were able to tie Evans to working at the Wambeck Mill in Manchester.
In the capacity of that employment, Mr. Evans worked directly under the gentleman who owns the Allenstown property where these victims were found and still owns it.
Those victims, a woman and three young girls, were found dead, stuffed in barrels. Some found in 1985, the others in 2000.
Through DNA testing, we've determined that this man, this killer, Bob Evans, is the father of the middle child victim in Allenstown, this young girl.
If Rasmussen had killed Lisa, do you think we would ever have learned about his connection to the Bear Brook murders?
No, we would have nothing. As we've been backtracking Rasmussen, we're looking for more victims. And as we keep digging into his past, it opens up more possibilities of more victims. He would single out single moms and start a relationship with them. And once he had total control over them, he'd murder them. They'd have young children. He'd take the kids with them and use the kids as a come on to the next victim, poor me, single dad. In the meantime, he's abusing the kids. And it looks like as the kids got old enough to talk about being abused, then he'd murder them too.
So Lisa got real lucky.
I'm sure he was about to kill Lisa. When Lisa was recovered, she stated that she was asked if she had other siblings, and she said yes, but they had died from eating quote-unquote grass mushrooms when they were out camping. When he was in the Anaheim area, Orange County area, 1984 and 85, we had eyewitnesses that he was seen with a woman that he was dating, and there were several kids in the car with her. We also have a woman who babysat for Lisa and another six-month-old when he was in Orange County. And we don't know what happened to the six-month-old, her mother, the woman he was dating. We know that he would have more than one woman on the string at a time. He would be grooming the next victim while he was still with the previous.
How many other victims might they be, and how far wide are we talking?
It's hard to say. I'm sure there's a lot more. Again, if he took 2 to 3 years to groom each victim, and you start adding the years up, there's definitely more out there.